So this is just a small status report, so to speak, just to show you what we have achieved so far. So let's just, we installed the module MyLogin User, which creates a confined user environment. And it's basically eventually supposed to be a one-in-all environment that you can basically tune on the fly to achieve your goals. So let's have a look at some of the booleans that it installs by installing the module. So get a cbool all and then list the ones that apply to my login user, which is the name of the module. So we have a couple of booleans here. So we have the CG rules engine daemon support, which basically, if you have CG rules engine daemon enabled on your system, then it wants to basically get some status, process status information of the user. And so far it only is allowed to get that from the user domain itself and not from the user applications, but I haven't seen any AVC denials with regard to it trying to get to the user applications. So we haven't edited that yet. KSM tuned, it's basically also for virtualization. It's also currently only allowing KSM tuned to get process state information of the user domain itself and not the user application domains. NumaD is off because this is I use it on a guest, but if you have it on a host, then you'll want to allow Numa to basically schedule your processes to various CPUs and stuff like that. And the unconfined support basically allows the unconfined domain, the unconfined users, to actually get the process state of the confined users, so that they can basically see that they're there and stuff like that. So it's on by default. It's on, yeah, by default, I think. And but currently, it only applies to the user domain itself. And we can simply, then we should do that in one of the next episodes. We could simply allow these three domains, secret, KSM tuned and confined, to basically read process state of any MyLogin user process. We declared a type attribute for all MyLogin user process types, and then we can basically allow these to operate on all the process types rather than just the user domain process type. So here you have three enable booleans. This is basically what I implemented recently. So here you can basically tell SE Linux whether the user should be able to log in via a various way. So let's, for example, try a local login. So set as ebool, and do it not persistent, and then basically enable my login user, enable local login. First, let me show you that it works when it's set to on. So I'll just copy this and I'll already type it in. Let's just go to the VM and then just send key to terminal 3. And then just log in my login user and then the password. And the user logs in ID. Alright, let's log out. And now let's just set the boolean to off. And now try that again. Oops. Let's try this again just to be sure. And now basically it asks you for a login context. I could say yes. If I say no, then access will be denied. See? And now somehow it's also getting stuck. But let's just try that yes again. Because there's always some smartass that tries to get around it. So let's just say yes. And then just say my login user are still not allowed. So you won't be able to log in if the boolean is basically set to off. Same for SSH. So let's just SSH into the system, SSH, and then my login user at SSH, and then netkb info, and I'm logged in. ID, exit. Now let's do this. Try this. This boolean here. Copy that and set it to off. And then just try that again. And now you can't get a valid context, but there's always some smart ass that will try this, for example. But it still won't be allowed. So you can't get in. So this is basically nice. So you can basically tune that on the fly, whether a user is allowed that or not. So the same with regard to, and I'll send key to back to terminal one. Same with regard to XDM. So let's just first show you how it's denied. So let's deny access first. Off. Set it to off. And login. And there you have it. So you can't log in. Set it to on. And now log in again. And now you're logging in. So I basically set up a very primitive desktop environment currently. So if you basically all the processes by default are confined, and I'm gonna give you a look at that. PS aux grab 10.12. And then less that. So all the processes have a private type. They all are confined. And the same goes for all the files, or at least most of the files currently are also protected, my login user. So if you look currently in the home directory, then you'll see a lot of private types, but there's also some stuff that has a generic type. For example, these desktop documents, downloads, music, pictures, public, template and videos. Those should remain generic because we want each restricted process to be able to fully interact with generic content so that we can basically share that content between the various confined processes. One thing I would like to do is create private types for the bash configuration files so that confined programs cannot actually operate on your or read your bash config. So that would be nice, so that those are protected as well, because there are those files can be abused in the system. So I want to, in the future, also create private types for those, so that those are protected as well. And then basically each confined process can basically operate on generic content. So for example, a confined Firefox can upload a file from your pictures directory, and your mail can basically attach a file from your music directory, and your Firefox can actually download a file to your downloads directory and stuff like that. So you can basically that's basically unprotected content, so to speak. The protected content is in cache, config, local usually, and then your SSH and then your pool stuff. So let's look at cache. So inside these directories are all restricted. So currently we only have a few programs, so I only support a default login, nothing, not much more. So all the stuff that basically gets started by default is confined, and their content is restricted. So this content is protected. If you don't have business in any of these directories, you won't be allowed there. Same goes for config. If you look at that, also each directory has a private type, so all this stuff is protected. If you don't have business there, then you can't get access. Same goes for local share. All private that's not a dot share, that's a normal share. All stuff here has a private type, so your key ring is safe. If you don't have business in the key ring there, then you won't have access. Because I say that because currently users can execute generic binaries with very little permissions. So many programs won't run, generic programs won't run because you don't have the permissions needed to run them. Although those exclude simple programs like ls and stuff like that. But so that's from an SSH perspective or from a shell perspective. But if you run, for example, a GNOME shell, then GNOME shell isn't allowed to execute any generic binaries. So let's have a look. Let's have see how that looks. So for example, if you want to open a terminal, and let's just say xterm, you open that, access is denied, and basically that goes for every program with, and you'll get an exception of course. For every program that you try to run, so calculator, same issue. Currently, you can't just run anything except the GNOME shell. So that's the thing that I did have policy for. It's also restricted, but you can basically also make this conditional. You can basically, if you want, just adjust this policy and implement a boolean that says this user cannot run a shell. So if you have a kiosk environment where you just want the user to only be able to run a protected and confined Firefox, which then you can basically do that and then just toggle off the protected and restricted GNOME shell. Say okay, you can't run that. You can do that on the fly, but currently that's just not done. So if you run it, the shell, then you'll basically be able to run the shell, and inside the shell you are the user domain. So you have the permissions of the user, which are very little. So for example, if I do ls all z root, permission is denied. If I do ls all z etc, then you'll get some stuff, and this is something that I'd like to change a little bit. But yeah, users by default just need some access to etc. For example, your shell needs to have some info in terminal info, for example. But also besides that, there's also some issue with regard to confining graphical user environments, because currently we basically domain transition to the user domain via the accession executable file. And basically there's a rule in policy that says if GDM runs the accession file, then transition to the user domain or to a domain that is specified with the default context and PAM SE Linux. So you can't really say when TDM runs the X session file, then transition to X session domain, because then you'll basically have a conflict with PAM, with how PAM works. We could adjust that, but I wanted this policy to basically integrate well into Fedora without too much hassle, and that's why some permissions are actually required or allowed. So you probably actually be able to read this file. So let's just cut etc torsoxconf. So yeah, it's not perfect. This is a lot, but on a positive note, you can't read password file, and in a stock Fedora config, you can read that as guest D, which is the least privileged login user that there is. In my policy, you currently cannot read password, and I hope to actually be able to to keep that functionality in there. So it's a pretty restricted shell, but there are some things that I already allowed. For example, you can receive your mail, your local mail. So the mail program, the XML program, is confined. There currently is no mail, but I can actually send a mail as root. See if I have it somewhere in my history. So let's just send a mail to root, and now I can just basically mail and find the mail and read the mail. So I can say one and it's there, and then just delete it and quit, and it's gone. So that works, it's confined. So this doesn't actually run in the user domain, so you still can't actually read what is it? Get var spool mail, and then my login user, is that it? Permission is denied. So I can't read the local mail myself, but the mail program can do that on behalf of me. So that's a cool feature, or at least that's something, because the mail program needs to basically create stuff in temp, and currently the user itself cannot go to temp. And I'm trying to basically not allow the user to use temp or tempfs, devsham. I'm trying to just restrict the user to the user home directory, so the programs that actually need temp are confined in their own domain, and those are allowed to use temp, but the user itself not. I'm just trying to do that, and maybe later I'll decide, okay, let's allow the user to, or conditionally allow the user to use temp anyways, but for now I'm trying to avoid using temp in the first place. So that's one of those things. Another thing is, by default in the beginning, in the very first chapters of my series, basically the user wasn't allowed to read any processes, and that's cool that you can't see any processes on the system. But later on in the last chapter, I've decided, okay, let's just classify all the user processes, all the processes of this user with a certain classification, and then just allow this user to only see its own processes. So I can do a ps auxc, which would normally in a normal system show all the processes on the system, and in this case it just only shows the processes of the user itself. So as you can see here, we have the GNOME terminal open, and that runs the GNOME PTI helper, and then there's the bash shell, which runs in the normal user domain. So all these are confined, and these are only the processes of this user, so you can't find any other process of other users. And you can if you want basically allow select processes and not all processes. So if I wanted to say, okay, this user cannot read the Pulse Audio processes, cannot see them, then I could basically just implement that easily, but doesn't really make sense. So, and the same goes for top. So you can run top, but it only shows your own processes, and even if you do if you implement or run top that would show all processes, it still wouldn't be allowed to do that. So some stuff already works, and some stuff is pretty confined. So we've stuff like free works, but df doesn't work because there's access denied, and currently it's spits out a lot of ABC denials, by the way, because it's still a work in progress. So that's basically the GNOME shell. You can't do much, you can only run the terminal, and you can basically just click these, but you can't open actually open them. So same here, you can't probe results, that doesn't work. So because you can't open the program, you're not allowed, GNOME shell is not allowed to run any program except the terminal. That's about it, I think. And yeah, and of course the some of the defaults that it needs to run. But you can log out, no problem, that works. Not sure exactly how that works, but it probably sends a debug message to systemd or something, or to XDM. Not sure how it does that. So you can basically peruse around, but you just can't do anything else. So dictionary access denied, everything is access denied. So this is basically just a base, a small base. That's the idea also. You can actually do something with the sound volume, I guess, but you can't actually run the network settings. It's access denied, so you can't get in there, you just see it. Same goes for most of these. Probably the power off probably doesn't work. I could try it. Let's just be brave and try it. And that actually works, or it doesn't. Yeah, it actually works. So that sucks. That is something that I really need to work on, because I don't want my user. Oh, actually it doesn't. Cool, it doesn't. It locks the user off. Let's see what ABC denials were related with that. And this should be just a small status report, but 1304, probably DBus related. Policy kit authentication, so that was denied. And then we have some other ABC denials. The terminal sends itself a signal, we need to allow that. And alarm notify needs to send itself a signal. Basically all these programs need to be able to send signals to itself. But this is probably what actually denied that access. Let's see if we have some DBus related stuff to that. No. Tail and 100 var log messages, so he can log out, but he cannot shut down the or restart the system. Order to allow. See if there's nobody. But so it was really policy kit that actually we prevented access to policy kit, and that's why it wasn't able to restart the system, but it was able to log out. Let's log in. But a lot of stuff is not tested yet. There's just a lot of work to be done. But the basics work, and it's a solid base, because well, the GNOME shell can't run any generic programs, and all the programs that can be run and that are run are confined. So they can only access what they need to access currently. So there's really some integrity in this environment right now, except then, yeah, and even for the login user itself, because login user itself can't actually, for example, even get into, for example, configs. Let's see, lslz config. Well, it can actually do some stuff in there, and already ABC denials, of course, needless to say. But it can't actually get into any of these directories. So that's even the user can't mess with its own files, its own owned files. So that's pretty neat. But eventually, that the user should be able, of course, to manage this content, I guess. But the idea is to keep the user domain as small as possible, so that even though the user can run generic programs, or at least could execute generic programs, it can't run them because the user doesn't have the permissions to run them. Because the user only has a small set of permissions, and that should be enough to actually do some bash scripting and stuff like that, but nothing big, no capabilities, no scary permissions, only the default permission. So I can, for example, do a echo test. That stuff works. That's the simple stuff, the simple shell stuff. But the more the stuff like, well, I don't know an example at this point, but the other stuff that should be doable. But I do have a problem with this etc listing etc. I think that's something I should try to avoid, actually. And the user can get enforcing status, by the way. Can enforce. I could also prevent that. In a previous policy, I even prevented that, so that when a user did this, it was simply saying as the Linux is disabled. But currently I don't do that, because other programs need to also run the ID command, and the ID command basically also reads the SELinux file system. So it's really a balance between usability and restrictions. And yeah, unfortunately the user can actually read generic etc files. It's really something that I don't like, particularly like, but the restricted, the content in etc, it can't access. So there is also stuff that it can't get to, and so actually it can get to its sudoers file. Can, although from a discretionary access control it can't read it, but from a mandatory access control perspective it would be able to read the sudoers file, which is a bad idea, I think. It's none of its business. But it can't write, so that's fortunate. So, and then there's this stuff that where you don't see the permissions there, you can't access. So that's basically the quick rundown of the current status. We have a pretty solid base, and you have at least a solid base to basically confine your for example your Firefox on, because you can be sure that Firefox only accesses what it needs to access. And but there's still a lot of work to be done, so that's it.